Hymn number 579.
Make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my griefs have taken, and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Amen. If you would turn over to hymn number 560. 560.
This evening.
Holy Heavenly Father, we do come before your presence this afternoon. Lord, just very grateful to be a part of your kingdom. Father, very grateful for the grace and mercy that you show us. Father, thankful for the salvation that you provided for us. Lord, as we look about us and see the creation you've created, we just stand in awe, Lord, of you, the Almighty God that has created all these things. And Father, we thank you that we can be here in this place and worship and serve you. And Father, Lord, thank you for the country we live in, where we've had the opportunity to be able to serve you freely for all these years. And Lord, though we see it deteriorating quickly, Lord, we just pray that you would just continue to help us to praise and worship and honor you no matter what happens. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for the offering that will be given tonight, and we just pray that you'd use it for your honor and glory, that our missionaries, Lord, will be equipped to do what they need to do. Lord, we love you and thank you for all you do. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Seated and turn over to hymn number 172. 172. This evening, turn over to hymn number 115. Hymn number 115.
Take your Bibles. We're going to be in 1 Peter chapter number 1. 1 Peter chapter number 1. First First Peter chapter 1, when you find your place, if you're able, I invite you to stand with me one more time this evening as we honor the reading of God's Word. We're going to pick up where we left off. We'll be in verse number 3. First Peter chapter 1 and verse number 3. The Bible says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory." I want to bring a message this evening of strength through hope. Our strength through hope. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you once again for allowing us the great privilege of being able to be here in the evening service. We thank you, Lord, that you allow us to be able to study through your word, the verse by verse, Lord, to be able to get some wonderful truths and treasures for our life today. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would meet with us, that you would speak to every heart, that you would draw us close to yourself. And we just want to thank you. We want to give you the praise for everything that's done. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Thank you. Please do be seated. Dr. Walter Wilson, I don't know if you've ever read the book, and I've spoke about him numerous times. If you get a chance, just get the book. It's you can find it on Kindle if you do any the readers, you know. I don't know if you can get it in real pages or not anymore, but it was a free download, well worth it. But it's Walter Wilson, and it's called Just What the Doctor Ordered, and it's a fantastic book. But he asked the question, he says, if you were to give a gift that would be suitable for the whole world, what would you give? That was a good question. Then he goes through and he lists different possibilities, and he shows how they're not all gifts are suitable for all people. He talked about books. He said, man, that'd be wonderful. Amen. That'd be right up my alley. That's great. Give some books. Some people can't read. He said, what about food? Well, some people eat different things in different parts of the world. What about clothing? Same thing. There's different parts of the world. Clothing is different depending on the climate. What about money? Not every culture makes use of money. So he came to the logical conclusion that only the gospel, with its gift of eternal life, was suitable for the entire world, the gospel. And he's right. You know why? It's because the gospel is what it is that gives us hope. Hope is the most important subject of our lives. I've shared with you the account before. It was December the 17th, 1927. It was a tragic day in American history. There was a S-4 submarine that was conducting routine drills off the coast of Massachusetts, and as it was starting to come up to the surface, there was a Coast Guard destroyer that went by and hit, and they collided, and knocked a 30-inch hole in the submarine, and so it began to descend into 110 foot of water. There were six of the sailors that were on the submarine that were able to get themselves into the torpedo room, and so they had a little bit of safety, the other side of it is they were running out of air very quickly. And so they were making rescue efforts, and there were divers that were going through, and they were trying to hook up airlines and see everything that they could do to be able to get air to those that were in need. And as they were doing the rescue efforts, they could hear this tapping, and they figured out that the sailors on the inside of the boat were sending Morse code. You think about it, of all the message that they had, they were tapping out, and they just over and over, they were asking the question, is there any hope? That's what they were asking. Some people believe that we're in a time of no hope. Quite honestly, if you got your hope from the government and you watched the presidential election, you would say, we have no hope. That's rough. We have a Savior, though, who is coming again. Amen? And that's where our hope is found. Hope is established in the Word of God. It's the Word of God that tells us all about Jesus, how He came the first time, how He's coming again for us. Too often Christians have learned to get away from the Word of God and to be able to live in accordance to what we consider to be common sense. Amen? Now, I'm not knocking common sense. I've worked in enough places where that was something that was lacking, and I can tell you it's very appreciated whenever you find that. But for the believer, our hope is not to be based on our own common sense. Our hope is based on the very promises of God. If you look to your left, you see the book of James. Let's go to James chapter 1 real quick. Notice what he says here in James chapter 1 and verse number 5. It's just one page to your left. James 1 and verse number 5 says, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him." Now think about that. What is the first requirement of attaining wisdom? Now before you say it out loud, it's not to ask. Oftentimes we say, we're supposed to just ask. Now, the first requirement for wisdom is to realize that you don't have it. Amen. Most of the time we're so comfortable in our common sense that we don't realize that we lack wisdom, which is why it is that we don't ask. We're not looking for answers too much. We want to impress somebody else with the answers that we already have. Whenever we recognize the need of our lives, then we start searching the scriptures to find the promise of God for the answer that we need. Then what do? We walk in the light of that promise. That's a biblical hope that God gives you. That's a biblical understanding. That's allowing the Word of God to be our authority in life. You can trust God on the basis of what it is that He's already done. Amen? You can have hope because we have a God who is faithful and true. How do we know that? First of all, in the Word of God. Secondly, we see it proved out day in and day out. Peter said in our text, he says, we have a lively hope. That's a great word, isn't it? A lively hope. I like that a lot. We think about hope. If he just said, hey, we've got hope, that's something. Hey, man, we'd look at that and we're like, man, we've got a hope. We talked about this on Wednesday nights not too long ago as we're looking about the return of the Lord. And remember, the hope is not just a pipe dream. Hope is a concrete expectation based upon the very promises of God. Amen? So just to be able to say we have hope and we understand that biblically, that's wonderful because our hope is the expectation that we have of God staying true to His Word. But then Peter goes the extra mile there and he says, not only do we have hope, but we have a lively hope. We have a living hope. What does that mean? It means it will never expire. As long as we have a living Savior, we have a lively hope. In Isaiah 58:11, it says, the Lord shall guide thee continually and satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. How is that happening? It's because the Lord shall guide thee continually. So I'd like for us to look just a little bit this evening about what Peter is saying about this matter of a lively hope. Now remember, he's talking to a group of people who are going through some intense, great persecution. He's got Nero that's been unleashed, and boy, he's just after believers, and they're going through, I mean, they're paying dearly. They're not just, you know, dealing with, you know, some routine struggles or something like that. Man, they're paying with their life. They're going through some great persecution, and yet in the midst of that, Peter looks at him and says, hey, we still have a lively hope. Amen? Now, I guarantee you, Peter could have sympathized with all of them and said, let me tell you about how bad the world is. We could all do that. But Peter says, I recognize how bad the world is. I recognize the hardships that you got, the tribulations that are going on, but we also have a lively hope. First thing it wants to see about that lively hope is that it begins with salvation. It begins with salvation. If you're not saved, this verse is not applying to you. You don't have a lively hope, but through Christ, you do. Now, notice what it says here in verse number 3. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Our hope is not a dead hope, amen? It's alive as the Lord Jesus Christ is alive. So the Bible says that if you are without Christ as your Savior, you are still dead in your trespasses and sins. That's what Ephesians 2 and verse number 1 says. Now that's the unfortunate life of many. As a matter of fact, that's the life of many people who find their names on a church roll. Yes, sir. But it's not having your name on a church roll that puts your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hope is not based on religion, but on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, in those seven letters to the seven churches, as Jesus was giving us those in the book of Revelation, we get to the church at Sardis in Revelation 3 and verse number 1. He says, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Now, what was he saying to the church there? He was saying, you have a name among men, but you don't have a name with God. Their works were dead because they were working in their own name instead of God's. The Bible says you must be born again. A person's not saved, get this, a person is not saved just because they believe in God. Amen? And a person's not saved even if They believe that Jesus is the Son of God. There, the Bible says that the devils believe and tremble. There's a lot of people that we meet to and meet with and ask if they die today, would they go to heaven? And an overwhelming answer is, oh, yeah, I pray. I know Jesus. I know who he is. Oh, yeah, I know that there's a God. That's wonderful. Doesn't mean that that is salvation. Salvation is whenever you place your faith in the finished work of Jesus for salvation. It's not just a matter of knowing him as a personality, but it's by putting all of your faith and trust in the death and the burial and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. When your faith is in the gospel of Jesus, the Bible says that's whenever you are born again of the Spirit of God. Nicodemus was a religious man. He knew all about the Old Testament. He knew a lot of things that you and I probably don't have any clue about whenever he studied through the Scriptures. And yet, he didn't know Jesus as his Savior. He had to be born again. John chapter 3, verse number 5 through 7, Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. A common misconception is that that people grow into becoming a Christian. They think, well, you know, I've gone to church this many times. I got my Sunday school pen, hadn't missed a day in 12 years. I must be saved. Listen, that's not true. You do not develop into being a Christian. You don't grow into being a Christian. You grow as a Christian. Amen. Once you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, that's when your sanctification begins. That's whenever you begin growing and you becoming more like the Lord and allowing him to lead. And you start seeing those fruits of righteousness that begin to manifest in your own life. But it's not because of a work that you do. It's because of what Jesus is doing in you because you're his child. Amen. Salvation opens the door of hope that sin could never budge into. John 14, verse 12, Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And Jesus died for the sins of the world. On the third day, he rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Amen. The resurrection gave assurance of the victory of Christ over sin and over Satan. As we've seen on our Wednesday study, the fact that we have a risen Savior is a further testimony of the fact that he is coming again. The more that we see in Scripture, he says, I'm not done yet. Amen. There's still more to come. Hey, listen, if he would have been done, he'd just stayed in the ground or whatever the case. No, he didn't. He rose from the grave and he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for us. He sent us the Holy Spirit to be able to guide us and to direct us in accordance with the Word of God, which is also a testimony that Jesus is coming again. Thomas, remember Thomas, skipped out on the evening service, missed out on Jesus. They came to him and says, hey, we have seen the Lord. And remember what he said, except I see the wounds in his hands and put my finger into the wounds of his hands and push my hand into his side, he says, I will not believe. Then lo and behold, next Sunday he's back in service, Jesus shows up. Amen. I wish, if there was one I'd like to see, that'd be a good one. You can just imagine Jesus going, come on. He didn't do it, did he? He didn't have to. He looked at it and guess what he had? He said, my Lord and my God. Remember, we give Thomas such a hard time about doubting Thomas, but he's also the first one to confess Jesus as Lord of the disciples. He says, my Lord and my God. Guess what happened with Thomas? His hope was made alive when he knew that Jesus was alive. You remember Stephen? Stephen in Acts chapter 6, he was going through and that great upright man, he began to give a great message to the Jews about their whole history. He just goes through the whole thing and says, let me start at the beginning with you guys. And he works his way all the way through. And then he gets to the point of Jesus and he says, oh, by the way, he's the one that you rejected and crucified. They were so upset with him. Remember, it says they gnashed on him with their teeth and they drug him outside of town and began to stone him to death. And you know what Stephen did? He looked up and he saw Jesus. Acts 7:56, he says, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. You know what happened? His hope was made alive whenever he saw that Jesus was alive. Can I tell you today, it's still the same. Our hope is alive whenever we understand that we have a living Savior. He is still alive and well. The fact that we have a resurrected Savior gives us hope because the same power that brought the resurrection of Christ from the grave is the same power unto your salvation. That's God working in you. In 2 Corinthians 13 and verse 4, it says, "For though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you." 1 Corinthians 15 and verse number 4 says, If Christ be not risen, then our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Think about it. If Jesus was dead, if Jesus was still in the grave, why in the world would we be here? Amen? There's no sense in that. Preaching is dead without the resurrection. Amen? Faith is dead without the resurrection. Your worship is dead without the resurrection. Which, by the way, means that our worship should be very much lively with the resurrection. We should never be able to sing, "Oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian," without a smile on our face. There are certain songs that really should spur us to be able to say, "Oh, I should probably be happy about singing this one. Oh, it is wonderful. Oh, it is wonderful." You know, there's just a difference that's there. Amen? How do we have joy whenever we sing? Well, I'll tell you how. Because we got a risen Savior. Man, it's the life of Christ that restores a lively hope in us. Listen, don't keep on in the dead works of the flesh and sin whenever you've got a lively hope through a risen Savior. See, the fact of the resurrection, it changes everything about what it is that you live for and what's important, because we know that he's coming back as well. Amen? We've got a risen Savior, and we have hope. Secondly, hope has an inheritance. Has an inheritance. That's good news. Amen? Everybody likes the word inheritance. Look at verse number 4. It says, "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you." That's great. You have an inheritance. Let me tell you this. You have an inheritance not because of what you do, but because of who you are. Galatians chapter 4 and verse number 7 says, "Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." Romans chapter 8, verse number 17, it says, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be glorified together." We're joint heirs with Christ. Amen. That's pretty awesome. Our inheritance through Jesus Christ, he says in verse number 4, is an inheritance that is incorruptible and undefiled. Man, just settle on that for a little bit. Incorruptible and undefiled. That means whenever we have an inheritance, we have an inheritance that will not defile you whenever you receive it. Amen? That's a blessing. You know, there are some things that are given to you as a gift that can defile you. I remember in the business world, it was pretty common. At Christmas time, a lot of our salesmen would bring a gift to some of those that they would deal with readily. Oftentimes, it'd be a bottle of liquor. It was a gift, but it was a gift that could defile you. I remember we had a Christmas party one time, and there was a $5 minimum. Everybody, whatever, or minimum, $5 maximum. None of you cheapskates, amen. You better get something good. But $5 maximum, that was your spending limit. So somebody bought 5 scratch-off tickets. That was their gift. White Elephant Gift Exchange. I know what they were thinking. You know, it was kind of a cute thing and something that'd be kind of fun, whatever the case. That's the way it was intended. But the love of money can quickly defile a person. You know what happened with one of those 5? All it takes is whenever you're scratching, you just won $20. That's all it takes. I think the devil knows that's all it takes too. Because whenever you do that and you're like, you know, I didn't even anticipate this. I'm just going to turn that 20 around and I'm going to do it again. Maybe I'll get 2 20s. And then before long, it's paycheck time. And well, I know I got my $100 on my paycheck, but you know, if I had that 20, I could put out of my paycheck. And before long, it's 40 and then it's 60. And before long, you're wasting all of what it is that you worked for. Yes, sir. Because there was that lust of the flesh, and lust of the eyes, and the pride of life that drives you in the wrong direction away from the things of God. You say, "Preacher, you're just old fuddy-duddy." Call it what you will. I'll take it. But it should be being a good steward of God's blessings. The splendors of heaven are incorruptible. Incorruptible, that's a great word. What does that mean? It means there's no hidden defects. No hidden defects in heaven. Amen? Whenever you get to your mansion, all the doors, they're not going to squeak. Amen? There's no junk drawers in heaven. Amen. There's not going to be a time whenever you're going to say, let's save the old pen that went out because the spring, I might be able to use it for something a little bit. There's none of that. It is incorruptible. No hidden defects. Our inheritance, it says, it fadeth not away in verse 4. Unfading. What does it mean? It never gets old. There's never a loss of luster. You know, this world has nothing like that. You know, everything fades in this world. I was thinking about this whenever I turned on the lights this afternoon. Whenever we replace these bulbs, these are all LED. They still are. Don't stare at them. I just did that. But whenever we first put them in, it was so bright. I mean, it was impressive bright. We went from the old fluorescence that took 30 minutes to warm up to get past, you know, mild orange. This was like, poof. I remember walking around and looking and saying, there's not a shadow in here. That was great. Amen. I like bright. I like whenever you're reading your Bible, you can see it. Amen. You know, I don't want people dozing off thinking, well, it's dark anyway. You know, no, this isn't a nightclub. Amen. We want to hit the lights, man. I want it to boom. You know, the LED thing, guess what? It's just like all the others. They go out like all the others. They fade like all the others. And I was thinking about that whenever I was thinking about heaven. It says it fadeth not away. There's no loss of the original glory of heaven. The first day that you see the splendors of heaven, a million years from then, you're not going to be able to look and say, it's a little duller than it used to be. It fadeth not away. There's nothing on this world that can compare to it. Isaiah 40 and verse number 8 says, the grass withereth, the flower fadeth. Amen. But the word of our God shall stand forever. He says, the flower fadeth. Think about that. The flowers that were so bright and vibrant this spring, whenever they popped out and all of a sudden there was some sun reflecting, you're like, wow. Guess what? It's faded away. Most of them are dead. You might have some more. But those spring ones are gone. Amen? By the way, if you're like, that's why I use silk, they're faded. Amen. It fades away. But in heaven, there's no loss of glory. No decay on the walls. And get this, whenever you think about that matter of decay, there's no lack of interest in the people. Can I tell you that whenever you get to heaven and you spend all that time worshiping, you won't get bored with it. You won't get tired of it. You won't think, we're singing again. No, you're just going to be so excited to be able to worship the Savior some more. He says that our inheritance is reserved in heaven. Reserved in heaven. That word reserved means it is protected and guarded. That's great. That means that nobody can steal it from you. It cannot be mismanaged. It's reserved for you. And that's the other thing. It's exclusive. He says it's reserved in heaven for you. For you. It's only for those who are saved by the grace of God. It's for the redeemed. Now listen, you cannot cry your way into heaven. You can't beg your way into heaven. You cannot buy your way into heaven. You can't bargain your way into heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. You only go through Christ. The inheritance. What is it? Man, I hope it's one of those gold harps I've been seeing. Been wanting to play. It's not a gold harp. It's not your own personal cloud. It's the eternal presence of Jesus Christ. It's the fullness of joy. The fullness of joy without the presence of sin. Just that in itself means I cannot fathom what it'll be like. Cannot fathom. But I'm excited to see it. That's our hope. Third, hope refines through difficulties. Now think about this, because here's what Peter's doing. He's going through and he says, hey, have you thought about heaven? Have you thought about your salvation? Hey, have you realized what it is that Jesus did whenever he redeemed you, whenever he paid for you, whenever he bought for you, whenever you received him as your Savior? Have you thought about what that does for your eternal life? Had you thought about the inheritance that you have? And then he brings them back and he says, I know there's still some difficulties at hand. Verse number 6. He says, wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Paul's been reminding the people of this lively hope, but he hadn't forgot about the state of their difficulties. And he says, there's three things there about these trials. Whenever you start thinking about the trials that they're going through, I guarantee you it was not far from their mind. Amen? You ever have somebody just give you something to take your mind off of things? Hey, here's something, boy, this is something I didn't think about. And that's wonderful. You can rejoice for a second, but your mind is always on the hardship that you got. Amen? He hasn't forgotten those, and he says, I want to tell you just a few things that God can do through those difficulties. He says those three things. He says, first of all, it's for a season in verse 6. He says, it's for a season. And then it says, if need be. And then also, he says, they're manifold temptations. So they're for a season. If need be, there's manifold temptations. There will surely be various trials that come. But the purpose of them is to refine their faith. Every trial that God allows, it's for your good and it's for His glory. Yes, sir. He wants you to know His ability to get you through. When you have trials that do nothing for you spiritually, then you miss the trial. Because God has an interest in growing your faith and growing your dependence upon Him through it all, whatever the trial. Whenever the trial becomes heavy and it's a burden to you, that's whenever there's a true refining. A true refining. Listen, nobody likes trials. Amen? Amen. Nobody likes that. Nobody's like, hit me again. Now, you don't do that. And yet, we start to recognize that God has a purpose in it all. And whenever the trials are so heavy, whenever the manifold temptations are there, whenever there's a heaviness of the burden, you know what we do? We humble ourselves and we go to God and we find that rest and peace and the strength that only God can give. We find a hope that is available in Christ that can't be found anywhere else. The times of heaviness, those are the times that we learn about our own limitations. Those are the days that we endeavor to look to God. Jesus knew heaviness. And remember this, in Jesus' life, He was tempted at all points as we are, yet without sin. Amen? He knew what it was like to endure a lot of the hardships that were there. And why would He do those things? He's given us a pattern. He's giving us an illustration of what it is that we can do as well. He's showing us how it is that there should be a dependence that we should have upon God. He knew heaviness while He was on this earth. In Matthew 8 and verse number 20, it says, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay His head. I don't think you can say that in a, you know, just an excited thing. Amen. That's not a verse that just tells us, it's like, man, I tell you what I don't have. This is great. As a matter of fact, He wasn't bemoaning it. He wasn't crying about it. But it was just a statement of a fact. He says, this is life. He understands what it means. In the Garden of Gethsemane, before His crucifixion in Mark 14, 34, He said unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. Well, what did He do then? The very next verse says he went forward a little and fell on the ground and prayed. If it were possible, the hour might pass from Him. The Bible tells us, He says, you know, whenever you're going through those heaviness of trials, whenever you're going through the manifold temptations, there is a purpose for that. And oftentimes it's so that we'll go a little bit farther and pray. Begin to lay things at the feet of our Lord. The Bible instructs us in Romans 12 and verse number 12, says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation. And then it says, continuing instant in prayer. We need the refining. We need the heaviness of trials to remind us that we need to be a people of prayer. Amen? I think it happens too often that we depend upon ourselves. In general. You say, I never do that. You're the exception. I think we all do. I'll use me. I do. I know there's times where I think this is the way that I'm supposed to do. This is the way this is supposed to be handled. This is what it is that I've done in the past. This is what it is. God doesn't want us to do that. Everything that He brings to us, He gives us as an opportunity to be able to go to Him instead. Say, Lord, what would You have in this situation? Lord, how can I meet the needs of that person? Lord, what would You have me to do? God, what is it that is going to bring honor and glory to You, not what I think is best? I'm always reminded whenever you study through the life of David, it was amazing how many times that David would be faced with a very similar situation. And one time God would say, I want you to go straight forward. And the next time He'd say, I want you to go around the back. What difference does it make? Amen? I mean, if going straight forward worked the first time, why didn't David go straight forward the second time? It's because God didn't want David to depend upon David. God wanted David to depend upon him. And the same thing is true in our life. He'll give us different trials and varying times and manifold temptations for a season if need be, so we can go through that heaviness so that we will go to God every time, trusting in him. So salvation, inheritance, trials, and then lastly, hope gets us to love. Hope gets us to love. Now look at what he says here in verse number 8. He says, whom having not seen, ye love. Now that's pretty great. Now think about this again. Here's Peter. He's writing to a people that are being intensely persecuted because of their faith, because of the Lord Jesus Christ, because of their stand for him. And he says, listen, I want to tell you about heaven. What a great thing we got going on there. But what are you going to have in heaven? You're going to have the closeness with your Savior. And then he says in verse number 8, whom having not seen ye love, in whom though now you see him not, yet believing ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Whom having not seen ye love. I haven't seen Jesus yet. Amen. But I know him. I know him. Do I know him to the degree that I want? Of course not. Think about the Apostle Paul. That was his plea as well, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. That was Paul's desire. Paul said, I want to know him. And we want to know him as well. And as long as you're drawing breath, you're going to have more opportunities to know the Savior in a greater degree, even though you haven't seen him. So how do we know him? We know him because we recognize his hand at work. We see the compassion of the Lord in our daily life. We know him because we recognize his desires instead of our own. It's amazing the number of times that you get your eyes off self and you start looking to God and you see that God is directing in a whole another area in a whole different direction than what you thought was going to be important. God's love for me reveals his character, his kindness, his mercy. I love him because he loved me when I was unlovable, which was like 5 minutes ago. Amen. We are unlovable people. I know that I'm an unlovable person. I'll take that one too. But God loves us. I heard the story of the first Chinese convert. They were studying through the Bible. Somebody had it was a young lady, and they got through. She was actually studying through the Bible, learning English. And they got to the account of Cain and Abel. And the girl asked, she said, if Cain would have come to God after killing Abel, would God have forgiven him? And the teacher said, yes. And she says, that's the God that I want to serve. Other religions don't know anything about a God of love. Donald Gray Barnhouse, he was a Presbyterian preacher, I think it was early 1900s, up to 1950s. Anyway, whatever it was. Yeah, it had to be. But anyway, he had a radio ministry, and that radio ministry went on for 11 years on the radio, and the only book that he ever taught out of was the book of Romans. That was it, nonstop through the book of Romans. And he recounted an event. He asked a young lady that was a Buddhist. He said, do you love Buddha? And she made the statement. She said she'd never actually thought about relating love with Buddha. She said it wasn't a concept that she was familiar with. Other gods are always inspiring fear, but Jesus Christ is love. Our love for the Lord Jesus Christ is a responsive love. We love him because he first loved us. He laid down his life for our sins. And the more that I think about his interest in my life, the more that I just spend a little bit of time and think about how it is that God has led and continues to lead, the more I love him. And the more thankful I am for the relationship that I have with him. It doesn't take much for me to sit and think of my family that God has blessed me with and the place that he's brought us from and the place that he's brought us to, and to be able to see his hand orchestrating it all, for me to recognize that God has a personal interest in my life and I love him for it. Those that pursue Christ, you will never be disappointed Never be disappointed. John said in 1 John 3 and verse number 2, we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. How are we going to see him? We're going to see the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. We're going to see the ultimate demonstration of love. We'll see the one who was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, was made an offering for our sin, all so we could be forgiven and have a restored relationship with our Heavenly Father. We'll see the one who's returning in power and glory. How do we get to see it today? Through the pages of Scripture. We also have a God who cannot lie. And he gives us time and time again that we can go through and read and see the promise of God and understand that the hope that we have is because of our risen Savior. When John saw Jesus in Revelation 1, verse number 17, he said, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand upon me. Isn't that wonderful? Saying unto me, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Think about John right there. He turns and he sees it was Jesus that was speaking, and he just hits his face. It would have been one thing for Jesus to go ahead and respond, say, hey, fear not, first and the last right here. He could have gone through the whole thing, but he didn't stop there, did he? Oh, he reached out. And he just laid his hand on John. You ever have a time where it's just like God just lays a hand on your life? And all of a sudden you realize that you're not in this for yourself. It's all for the glory of God. And you have a God who loves you and cares for you. And regardless of the trials, the manifold temptations that you have, you recognize that that it'll be for a season, if need be. We go through those heaviness, but we just keep looking to the Lord. We have strength today because of our hope in a risen Savior. We have that expectation that he's coming again. If you're not ready to meet him, you need to be saved tonight. Amen? Oh, never put off the grace of God and the opportunity to receive Christ as Savior. You can come tonight. Maybe you're going through the trials of life. You may be going through things just beyond belief. Maybe that nobody else knows it, but you know it, and God knows it. You know what you can do? You have the freedom to be able to come to him, lay him at his feet, ask for him to take that load. And you know what he'll do? He'll put that hand on. He'll guide you through. We have a faithful God. We have a hope because we have a resurrected Savior. Amen? Let's stand together and we'll have a hymn of invitation. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your love for us and grace, and thank you for your blessings. Thank you for the great love that you have for us. Lord, we're so grateful that even through the midst of different trials and circumstances and difficulties, Lord, that we can always find our comfort and grace and help in time of need in you. Lord, we just ask, Father, that you would meet with us, each one, Lord, for different difficulties that are being experienced this time. Lord, we just pray, Father, that you would get the glory of it. I pray, Father, that you would always find us an humble-hearted people, ready to yield to you, desire your presence, seek your face and your grace, Lord, to be able to turn all things over to you. And we just want to thank you for it. If there's one here that doesn't know Christ as Savior, Lord, I pray that today would be the day that they not run from you, Lord, that they stop trying their own way, but that they would trust in Jesus and him alone. We want to thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Number 328.
328. Just need to pray. Why don't you come as we begin to sing this first verse.